Hey there, I'm Mr. Terry. I'm a high school history teacher. Welcome back to another History Teacher Reacts video. And I hope you're having a great day today. All right, we're back with another Fat Electrician video, and this one seems to be even more popular than normal. It's titled, America Obliterates Half North Vietnam's MiG-21 Fleet in 13 Minutes, Operation Bolo. All right, the original video is going to be linked down below. Please support the Fat Electrician. He's been such a friend of the channel. All right, let's get to some Vietnam War history.
Ah yes, that time during the Vietnam War where the United States Air Force finally agreed to let a double fighter ace pilot from World War II run the show, he then immediately saw to the destruction of over half of North Vietnam's state-of-the-art fighter jets, and he did it in 13 minutes. Today we're talking about Operation Bolo, one of the greatest ruses in military history, but first,
an elaborate
word from our sponsor.
Who we got today? Fishing game.
When I told you to get a hobby, this isn't what I meant.
You said I could pick up fishing.
Not like this.
Why?
To get out of my hair.
I don't know why she's mad. This is way better than real fishing. Fishing Clash lets you catch way more fish than you ever could in real life from locations all across the world from the comfort of your own home. All right, so Operation Bolo takes place within another mission known as Operation Rolling Thunder, and Operation Rolling Thunder spans from March of 1965 until November of 1968. It is essentially...
The Operation Rolling Thunder was really an expansion of the Vietnam War effort. But this time, the United States have really been pulling the reins now to protect the South, okay, however you want to call it there. And boy, it involves the biggest bombing, some of the biggest bombing we've ever seen in world history. It was crazy.
Actually, the air war over North Vietnam. So, super brief, oversimplified version of what's going on. The American forces are in South Vietnam, and they are fighting the VC, or the Viet Cong, which is a guerrilla fighting force. And that guerrilla fighting force is receiving supplies from the North Vietnamese via the Ho Chi Minh Trail. So, America needs to try to shut down those supply lines.
A lot of people think that this war is just North versus South, but it's not true. Viet Cong operate inside of South Vietnam. There is support of the North, right, in the South. This wasn't just a cut and dry thing of North versus South, which made this even more difficult for the Americans to deal with. It's not so cut and dry. You don't know who the enemies are often.
From the North Vietnamese via the Ho Chi Minh Trail. So America needs to try to shut down those supply lines.
So the Ho Chi Minh Trail, if you see on the most problematic thing about the Ho Chi Minh Trail was that it went through countries not part of the war. So Laos and into Cambodia. And so bombing took place in those areas, which also heavily destabilized and killed countless amount of people in those countries, which destabilized those countries. And it often is often seen as the precursor to the rise of new regimes like the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia, which was incredibly devastating.
Logic being, if the enemy doesn't have supplies to fight, the enemy can't.
And also villainize the Americans more so in Southeast Asia
type stuff, right? Okay, well, America pretty much has two options. They can A, invade North Vietnam with ground forces, or they can
they don't want to do that.
Just attempt to bomb the holy fuck out of them. And yeah. America's going with option B, and that is what Operation Rolling Thunder is. It is just a humongous 3-year-long air bombing campaign where America is going to try to blow up so much North Vietnamese infrastructure that they can't continue to support the Viet Cong. Which honestly, it's a really good plan. What's the problem? The enemy's got nice things. Oh, we'll take the nice things away. Send the planes in, bomb the roads, bomb the railroad tracks, and make it so they can't give the enemy a bunch of supplies. It's good. It should work. And then the politicians got involved. And let's face it, if anybody could mess up something so simple, it's going to be a politician because, well, honestly, they could probably fuck up boiling water. So how on earth did they mess it up? Well, they gave the American military a bunch of rules of engagement, which is a fancy way of saying they gave the American military a bunch of rules that only they have to follow and the enemy doesn't, essentially tying the U.S. military's hands behind its back and then sending them into battle anyways. And one of these rules of engagement, or one of these protocols that they had to abide by, was that every plane that went into North Vietnam to bomb them had to travel through a particular air corridor, and that is the only route they were allowed to take into North Vietnam. Meaning that pretty much immediately the North Vietnamese picked up on the pattern that every single plane that flies into their country follows a particular path, and they then proceeded to take all of their surface-to-air missiles, all of their radars, all of their anti-aircraft capabilities in the entire country and put them in this one particular spot. And then the U.S. government decided to keep making their guys fly right through it anyways the entire time. Now,
so military action and political action will always be one and the same, especially when you have a democratic country where politicians have influence and also have to deal with international relations. You know, it's not some absolute monarchy, right? Like in the United States. So there will always be a connection between politicians and warfare. It's always going to exist in a democratic state. Because there is always going to be political backlash. There's relations to deal with here. And you have these different interests all happening at the same time, right? Militarily trying to do the job, but then politically, and you have the world stage and all that stuff, and the big picture to think about. You also have that going on. So things are always going to get messy. But I don't know, what do you guys think about rules of engagement and things like this? Now, you could go and strip this all back further to, like, did the United States need to be there in the first place? And if so, then, you know, how should this war have looked? And Vietnam was always changing like that. It was supposed to be something where it was supposed to be a proxy war first, right? It's the Cold War. Proxy wars are the thing to do, right? Meaning you support people to fight against each other. So you don't have to fight, right? You're like, you don't want China to fight the United States, Soviet Union or something to get involved in the United States, depending on the conflict, because you're talking about nuclear powers and mutually assured destruction and all that stuff. But it brought in that idea of, what if the proxy war is failing? Should that be an end of the involvement of the United States, right, from that perspective, because the proxy war was lost? The proxy war was lost right there. So that's why the United States goes boots in the ground. Should that phase continue? And that was the big part of, you know, Truman Doctrine and domino theory that was going down in Vietnam.
Now, at this point, you're probably thinking, oh my God, the politicians might actually secretly be geniuses, because what they've done is they have inadvertently gotten the North Vietnamese to gather all of their anti-aircraft resources into one location. And now we can just bomb those, take them out, and they'll have nothing left, and it'll just be green light, go everywhere.
He's not going to let off the politicians.
Like, politicians, can I blow that shit up now? Because it's right there just waiting for me. To which the politicians are like, absolutely not. In fact, we're going to make it a rule that you're not allowed to bomb or attack any anti-aircraft sites, any surface-to-air missile arrays, any anti-aircraft anything. You have to leave it completely unscathed. And our logic behind that is that at those sites, there could potentially be a Chinese or a Soviet advisor that's helping out the North Vietnamese. And if we hurt one of them, it would upset the Soviets or the Chinese. And then that would be bad diplomatically, even though they're blatantly there to help run a proxy war against us. We're going to go ahead and care more about them than we are about our own pilots. So we're going to go ahead and just have you guys keep flying through that same air channel, through all the anti-aircraft, everything. Thing, because fuck you, that's why.
This stuff too, a lot of these rules engagement too are also about civilian populations as well, but we've already talked about, though, how the lines between civilian and combatant, because you're dealing in that country, there's no battle lines, there's no neutral battlefield or something like that. It's almost inherent that civilians are going to be there, right? Which is when you have to discuss the risk reward, whatever it is you're trying to get out of this war. Hey, we got Big Daddy.
This is bullshit. So that's exactly what happens. Every single time they fly a mission, every Air Force, Navy, and Marine Corps plane has to fly through the same air corridor through a gauntlet of anti-aircraft capability on their way to deliver their payload. And then if that wasn't bad
definitely
enough,
handcuffed,
the enemies
that's
got
for sure.
Their hands on somewhere between 12 and 16 MiG-21s. And if you don't know, at this point in time, the MiG-21 is the new cutting-edge Soviet fighter jet. It is incredibly fast. It has a very high
good.
Flight ceiling.
The new generation.
Very nimble. And using these MiG-21s, they very quickly develop a strategy that amounts to basically guerrilla warfare in the sky, utilizing a hit-and-run tactic. So their strategy is that they are
because,
gonna go-
well, even with that technology, the American Air Force and air superiority is just, like, unmatched, absolutely unmatched. You could have some good tech, but U.S. has good tech, too.
Oh, specifically after the F-105 Thunder Chief, a.k.a. the Thud. It is the number one plane that America is using in Operation Rolling Thunder in all of their bombing runs, and when it is weighed down with a bunch of bombs, it is basically a sitting duck for a MiG-21. So what ends up happening is every time a bunch of thuds get sent out on a bombing run, they have to fly through that corridor of anti-aircraft capabilities, and the arrays and everything else tells the enemy that it's a bunch of F-105s going on a bombing run, so they scramble the MiG-21s, they go up there, they intercept intercept these F-105s, at which point one of two things can happen. The F-105s can continue on their bombing run and most likely get shot down by the MiG-21s, or they can drop their payload just over the jungle randomly in the middle of nowhere, not on target, and then make an escape and live. And bear in mind, the North Vietnamese only have a couple of these fighter jets, and they're fighting a war of attrition against a much larger industrial force like America, so they are more than happy to send a plane up there, burn a little bit of fuel, get the Americans to drop tens or hundreds or millions of dollars worth of bombs on the middle of nothing, waste all their money, waste all their time, and then take their planes and land. They don't need to go out there and waste all their missiles and risk their planes. They're just going to get the Americans to waste all of their bombs on nothing. And
this is where those conversations were really happening, where it's like, if you're going to handcuff, he's using the term handcuff, right? The U.S. military, and have all these rules and obviously try to avoid foreign entanglements with, again, the Chinese or Soviet Union. And if you're so worried about that, does that again bring in the question? This was what people were asking at this time, is like, then why still be there? Why be there if you have all of these stipulations? Because it's obviously going to limit your success, but it's also showing that the success is not worth what it takes to get there, which would be having to break all these other rules and have diplomatic problems, right? This is what a lot of people were saying in the military and out of the military during Vietnam, is it's like you go full in or you don't go at all. And doing this halfway thing doesn't help anything except just kill people, right? Just kill people and waste money and, again, still look bad on an international scale.
I know what you're thinking. That seems like a pretty easy problem. What if we just bombed the MiGs while they were on the ground? Or what if we bombed the airfields that they were coming from? That way they couldn't even take off. Well, luckily we have politicians to step in and tell us once again, you're not allowed to bomb those either, because there could potentially be an advisor from China or the U.S.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
so leave those alone too. You're only allowed to take out enemy planes when they're in the air. To which the U.S.
Does that prove the point that it's time to be gone? Like, why still conduct this war if all of these things are being limited? You know what I mean?
Military's like, okay, I guess.
So confusing, right? For everyone involved.
We'll just send up our fighter jet, the F-4 Phantom 2, and try to go toe-to-toe with the MiGs. Okay, so the stage is set. We have one of the sexiest airplanes of all time, the American F-4 Phantom 2, going toe-to-toe with the Soviet MiG-21.
Nice jet.
Okay, here's what I need you to understand about this matchup. This is pretty much the golden era of military planes, okay? In my opinion, it's right before stealth technology came out and planes started to get a little bit slower because they could be sneaky now. No, planes built during this period.
It's like the golden age of dogfights, I guess you would say, right? And what I mean by that is obviously dogfights and like World War II and stuff, but have more of that way more of that technological superiority. I could see what he's saying there.
Straight up, let's be fast as fuck and carry a ton of firepower. It's the hot rod era of military planes. And both of these planes
That's a good way to describe it.
The F-4 Phantom tops out at like 1,400 miles an hour. The MiG-21 tops out at like 1,300 miles an hour. The F-4 Phantom is like twice the size of the MiG-21. It's got a way bigger fuel tank. It's got way more range. It can carry a lot more payload. The MiG-21, on the other hand, it's a lot smaller. It's a lot lighter. It's nimbler, but it doesn't have as much range. So the MiG-21 in an up-close dogfight is probably going to be better with its gun, whereas the F-4 Phantom, not really
seems better defensively.
Up-close dogfighting, it doesn't even have a gun because it has a more advanced radar and missiles that can take the enemy out from 29 miles away. It doesn't even need to see the enemy to shoot him out of the sky, so why on earth would it need a gun? Okay, the F-4 Phantom's MO is
gotta have a backup,
ass,
right?
Shoot half-court shots and have a dope-ass paint job the entire time it does it. So just so we're on the same page, Soviet MiG-21, American F-4, very much peers to one another. They are both capable of taking the other out. They both pose a huge threat to one another. However, theoretically speaking, the MiG-21 should have an advantage in an up-close dogfight due to its maneuverability and its gun, whereas the F-4 has the advantage because it can just shoot down the MiG-21 before it even gets close enough for a dogfight to occur. So, MiG-21, better up close. F-4, better far away. So that's it. Okay. That's the solution, right? The F-4 Phantoms are going to go up. They're going to shoot the MiGs down from like 20 miles away before the MiGs even know they're there. And that's going to be the end of it. Ta-da! Luckily for the North Vietnamese, the American politicians step in yet again with another exciting rule of engagement. Guess what? You're not allowed to shoot at enemy aircrafts until you have visual confirmation that it is an enemy aircraft. Translation, the American F-4 pilots literally are not allowed to start fighting the MiG-21s until the MiG-21s have the advantage, which is absolutely...
So it's like confirmation, right? Trying to... reduce the collateral damage. I guess you get that. So you can see from like the political perspective what they're trying to avoid, again, international entanglements. Remember, this is the mid-60s. It's like height of the Cold War, right? Cuban Missile Crisis. You got to understand, there's some other context going on in here. The Cuban Missile Crisis has just ended and was beginning the detente. It was beginning the normalization, I guess you should say, of American and broadened out communist relations other than with Vietnam. But like was starting to do that. Right. So like they were on this path, especially with the Soviet Union, of they are out of the biggest, you know, the biggest crisis, right, of the entire Cold War, and don't want to see as a provocation for that. So there's a big picture thing going on that maybe that helps you understand, I think, the politician's perspective. But again, it just keeps coming back to this thing, though. It's like, how can, like, what do you do about this war if you're going to have all of these rules and stuff like that and kind of play it in the middle? It's like a no-win situation, right?
Absolutely insane to think about. Like, literally the equivalent of walking up to an infantryman and being like, hey, here's a sniper rifle. Also, you're not allowed to shoot people with it. You're only allowed to use the bayonet. And there's no bayonet because we didn't design it with a bayonet lug because it's only designed to shoot people from really far away. Get bent. And just in case that wasn't bad enough, what makes this even worse is the fact that most of the F-4 pilots are only trained on the American F-4, which wasn't really designed for up-close dogfighting with a gun because it doesn't have a gun. So most of them don't really know how to conduct an up-close dogfight because they've never been trained to do it. Because that's not what their plane is supposed to fucking do.
So if there was actually at this time, context is key here, guys. What if that was an attacking a like a Soviet plane? That would have been catastrophic for the progress that was made, you know, just in the last couple of years before this. It would have been catastrophic for political relations, especially because the United States is clear over here on the other side of the planet doing this. It would have been seen as a massive provocation from the Soviet perspective, whether that's true or not, just because it's like, well, you're in a war zone, you know, so it's obviously going to complicate it. But the context here for these political decisions is making more sense. But again, it's just like, how do you have a good war effort?
So there's really no good answer.
How can you have a full war
for a little while, where basically the F-105s go up, the MiG-21s go up,
horrible diplomatically.
The F-105s are then forced to drop all their bombs in the middle of nowhere and take off just so they can survive. The MiG-21s then go and land, and that just repeats itself ad nauseum. But then in September of 1966, something happened that would change everything, because the 8th Fighter Wing out of Udong Thai Royal Air Force Base would get a new commander, and that commander was none other than the legendary fighter pilot Colonel Robin Olds. And I mean, you can know nothing about this
Liam
guy
Neeson?
And you already know he's the main character. I mean, look at the lip sweater on this man. It's the most magnificent taco flosser I've ever seen in my entire life.
Can't that is a good mustache.
Anytime
that's
you've
a
ever
good
seen
mustache.
A movie with the cool bad boy character that doesn't follow the rules, it's also a fighter pilot. Yeah. It's based off of this guy, whether you know it or not.
Can't oh, really?
You understand the gravity of the situation?
We're just saying
this
that.
Man's mother passed away
he is Maverick.
When he was 4 years old, and he was raised by a single father that was also a full-time Army pilot and a World War I veteran. This guy was essentially bred to be a fighter pilot. He went to West Point, where he became an All-American football player at 6'2", 250 pounds. He then went on to become a fighter pilot in World War II. Now,
boy,
if you shoot down five or more enemy planes, you become an ace pilot. It's kind of a really big deal. And Robin Olds was a double ace in World War II.
Is that his, hold on, is that his trophies?
Pilot, it's kind
you see
of
that
a
on
really
his plane?
Big deal. And Robin Olds,
he's got these, like, yeah, he's got some insignia right over here. There it is.
Was a double ace in World War II. This man literally prestiged in the most extreme air-to-air combat the world has ever seen. And he's about to become a triple ace in Vietnam. And at the age of 44, nonetheless, how's the old saying go? Beware of an old man in a young man's game. Yeah, this is the main character for sure. And like most great main characters, Robin Olds has a lot of very high-ranking people that don't really like him that much, mostly
that
because
guy,
he's
man.
Not afraid to ruffle a couple of feathers to get his point across. And most recently, the argument that he's been having with the establishment is the fact that the F-4 Phantom, the main fighter jet for the United States military, should probably have a gun on it. He also has an issue with how these new pilots are being trained, because they're not really being trained how to actually dogfight. They're just being trained how to haul ass, intercept a plane, and shoot a missile at it, as opposed to actually getting into a close quarters fight. And the chain of command is basically telling Robin Robin Olds, like, hey, look, you're old. They don't do it like that anymore. You were fighting in World War II in P-51 Mustangs and P-38
Lightnings. He's like, get with the
times.
This
is not what's going on anymore. These kids are flying F-4 Phantoms that can fly at 1,400 miles an hour and shoot missiles and take out targets from 30 miles away. We don't need to teach them up-close dogfighting anymore because they're never actually going to use it because the technology eliminates the need for that. But you know what technology doesn't fix? Politicians being fucking stupid. So now everybody has to fight like it's World War II in a dogfight because they're not allowed to use the technology the way they're supposed to because politicians that don't understand what they're talking about get to make up all the rules. So now...
What do you think Nick thinks about politicians?
They're sending Robin Olds to go take over command of the 8th Fighter Wing. He shows up and immediately earns everybody's respect. Keyword, earns it. Doesn't just get it given to him. And the way that he earns it is one of the best examples of leadership that I have ever read about. This man shows up to take command of an entire fighter wing as a double ace World War II pilot and a legend. And he decides...
This now sounds like Top Gun 2. Right, the Maverick, not Top Gun, Maverick, the newer one where you have like, yeah, Tom Cruise coming in, then you got like the young guys and they're like, what are you doing here, old man? You know, and then you got to earn their respect the old school way.
To immediately put himself on the flight roster as a rookie to get trained on how to better use the F-4 Phantom because he's not very well acquainted with it. And he lets all the men that are lower than him train him on this plane. He didn't come in all cocky. He wasn't some arrogant prick. He just admitted, hey, I've been doing this for a long time. I've flown a lot of planes. I'm not super great with the F-4 Phantom. I need to get great with it so I can lead you guys. And that's exactly what he did. And it immediately earned him all the respect in the world. So Robin takes some time to get acquainted with the F-4 Phantom, and within a couple of weeks, he's already flying the plane better than most of the trainers. So now that Robin Olds is caught up on the F-4 Phantom to where all of his guys are, he is now going to teach these young whippersnappers how to dogfight like it's World War II. And this is like the cool moment from all the movies where old schools teach a new school how to get shit done anyways, okay? This is Rocky teaching Adonis Creed how to box. This is Doc teaching Lightning McQueen that sometimes you got to turn right to go left.
I was totally thinking when they showed this, like, this is a music montage clip, I feel like, right now happening.
And while all of this is happening, Robin Olds, in another great display of leadership, realizes that there's not enough of him to go around, and he needs backup. He needs another badass World War II era pilot to come over and help him get these guys ready. So Olds calls in a couple of favors, gets one of his longtime friends transferred over to the 8th Fighter Wing to help him run the show, and that friend is none other than the legendary pilot Daniel Chappie James Jr., a.k.a. the Black Eagle. Okay, in the late 1930s, early 1940s, like this man was a civilian pilot at the Tuskegee Institute that was contracted by the U.S. government to train U.S. pilots how to fly. Okay, if you're not picking up, I'm putting down, I'm trying to tell you, this is the man that trained the famous Tuskegee Airmen from World War II before eventually enlisting and becoming one himself in 1943. After enlisting, he...
Yeah, still had segregation in the military at that time. So one of the most famous of the segregated groups.
Became an officer, at which point he was deemed too valuable as a trainer, so that's what he did for the duration of World War II, continued to train an entire generation of fighter pilots, and never actually saw combat himself. Then, in Korea,
military now been desegregated, by the way, after World War II.
Before working at the Pentagon, where he would end up meeting Robin Olds. After this, he goes on to become the first black man to become a four-star general in the United States military. This man is also a complete badass, so Uncle Sam is essentially playing Operation Bolo on co-op mode with two main characters on the field. So, Chappie shows up to the 8th Fighter Wing, is reunited with his old friend Robin Olds.
What a squad, huh?
Effective chain of command, and they are absolutely loved by all of their subordinates. Because of that, this leadership duo is given a nickname that is originally intended as a term of endearment, although by today's standards is probably not very politically correct, and that nickname was Black Man and Robin. Now, all this happens in like the span of 3 months.
Oh,
so, December 1966, they're running combat operations, and Robin Olds finally gets an idea of how to stop these new badass MiG-21s. By this point, Robin Olds is completely caught on to the MiG-21's entire strategy. They have zero interest in actually fighting with the F-4s, which is driving Robin Olds nuts because he's a World War II era fighter pilot. That's exactly the type of shit that he's into. These MiG-21 pilots, however, just want to go up there, use guerrilla warfare tactics where they just either hit the F-105s or don't hit the F-105s and just convince them to drop their payload prematurely and waste everybody's time and then take back off. The MiG-21s have zero interest in tangling with the F-4s, which Robin Olds interprets as, I need to force these MiG-21s to fight me. So how's he going to do that? Well, yeah. Here's his plan. The reason the MiG-21s can identify the F-105s so efficiently is because the F-105s have a jamming pod on them that basically disrupts and interferes with the surface-to-air missiles down below, it messes up their radar so that the F-105s aren't going to get taken out by all the anti-aircraft stuff on the ground. Right. Problem with that is that emits a frequency that the North Vietnamese can see. Right. They then know that a bunch of F-105s are coming, so they scramble the MiGs. So Robin Olds just...
So would you, could you remove those? This is actually a question I have. Remove that, depending on the type of mission. Like, what are you fearful more of? Is the stuff in the air or the stuff on the ground? You know what I mean?
Besides, hey, let's take those jamming pods, mount them to mine and all the guys' F-4s, and then we'll fly there like we're F-105s in a bombing formation, and the MiGs will come attack us. And by the time they get close enough to realize go, they're not F-105s, ideally, it's going to be too late. Yeah, the legendary World War II double fighter aces just went to the chain of command and requested permission to execute the old Wile E. Coyote in a sheep costume to catch the Roadrunner strategy. Now, probably going to work, but there are a bunch of problems with this idea. Biggest problem right out of the gate is this doesn't solve the issue with rules of engagement, because remember, you're not allowed to fire on the enemy until you have visual confirmation that it is your enemy, and by then the MiG-21s have an edge in air-to-air combat.
Again, just to reiterate the context here of coming out of the height of the Cold War and an actual bettering of relationship, everything was extremely fragile politically right now, extremely fragile. There was positivity, positive, constructive things happening that could easily be disrupted by one mishap. Okay, that's the political perspective.
Robin has
here
a two-step plan for that as well. Okay, step number one,
gotta be 100%
that they only
sure
have 12 to 16 MiG-21s, so he's just going to roll in with 28 F-4s, okay? Just completely overwhelm them, even if they do have an edge in air-to-air combat. Okay, step number two, which is quite frankly the big ask, he wants the entire U.S. military to shut down all air operations over Southeast Asia while he conducts this operation. He wants the Army, the Air Force, the Navy, the Marine Corps, none of them to have any birds in the sky whatsoever. And his reason for that is so that he can bypass the rules of engagement. You see, the only reason the politicians are enforcing that rule of engagement where you have to have visual confirmation before you fire on an enemy plane is because there's a ton of planes in the air over Southeast Asia at all times, and Vietnam is already super controversial over in America, and the last thing the politicians want to have to deal with is headlines that an American plane shot down another American plane. Yeah. So they just made the rule you're not allowed to shoot at anything unless you can visually see 100% for certain that it is in fact an enemy. So if...
That's important, really important to understand for the big picture as well, is the opinion of Americans. Remember, a democratic state, the will of the people is absolutely crucial, right, for a war. And at a time when you the war was already growing in controversy because a lot of the misinformation that had come out about like things that got the United States there, how the United States was operating, again, by Americans, you couldn't have bad press. You couldn't have bad press both locally and internationally because of your dealings with other countries, again, like Soviet Union.
Robin can make sure that the only planes in the sky are his guys and the enemy. He should be able to go bombs away the entire time and not have to worry about it. So obviously, this is a massive request, and the chain of command says yes.
You son of a bitch.
Yeah,
okay, so now the last thing we gotta figure out, how do we make sure that these MiG-21s don't slip away? Because they're so nimble and they're so fast, they could pull a tight maneuver and be back at base before we're gonna be able to catch them. So, how are we gonna prevent that? As soon as the MiG-21s take off and get in the air, they're gonna send half of the F-4s to haul ass past the entire future battlefield, and they're just gonna do hot laps around the enemy airfield, making it so the enemy can't go to land without fighting through those F-4s first, which effectively is gonna give the pilots of the MiG-21s two options. They can stand and fight the F-4s, retreat, and fight the other F-4s, or they can retreat, have nowhere to land, and eventually run out of gas. And remember, the F-4s have a much larger gas tank, so they are definitely going to run out of gas first. So it's a perfect plan. There's just one small problem left. How are we going to know when the MiG-21s take off and leave the airfield? Because if we send the F-4s out too soon, then the MiG-21s won't take off at all, and then we can't bomb them on the ground, and it defeats the entire purpose of the mission. Easy problem to solve. We're going to get two spy planes, a C-130, B-2, AKA
big boy, huh?
Silver Dawn. At this point in time, it is a state-of-the-art electronic warfare spy plane, and it's going to be able to receive all the enemy radio transmissions, so they're going to be able to tell as soon as the enemy MiG-21s take off. And obviously, given the fact that that was such an easy problem to solve, bureaucracy is obviously going to step in and make it extremely difficult, because the U.S. military only has like 20 of these Silver Dawn spy planes, and while they are technically the property
Where
of the United
they?
States Air Force, they are directly under the command of the NSA, the National Security Agency, and they are super-duper stingy agree about whoever gets to use these planes. Basically, the NSA gets final say as to whether or not this plane gets to participate in this mission, and that means that they're going to have to go through some stupid bureaucratic process where they ask for permission, it gets run up the chain of command like 30 people deep, and then finally some bureaucrat has to take responsibility. They're not going to do that because they don't want to put their ass on the line, so it's probably just going to be a big fat no, you can't use this plane, even though it's probably going to make the whole mission work. Now, this is normally the part of the story where the hero strategically transfers a piece of equipment to an alternate location so that he can get the job done.
However,
he doesn't have to do that because what they do instead is decide to not tell the NSA anything.
What?
I don't know. Won't hurt her.
See, that kind of stuff gets you in big trouble after the war. You will never be trusted again. That's risky.
And when I say they're not going to tell the NSA anything, I mean they are somehow going to keep it a secret from the NSA, the whole part of the story where the Navy, the Marine Corps, the Air Force, and the Army ground every single bird that's not on this mission. They're going to somehow keep that a secret from the fucking spy agency so that they go ahead and send up their two Silver Dawns doing hot laps around the Gulf of Tonkin that they have going around every single day so that those two planes are in the air participating on this mission, whether the NSA knows it or not. And then as soon as the mission kicks off, they're going to radio over to them and just have them tell them whether or not the MiG-21s took off. It's both genius and hilarious because now, even if the NSA does find out after the fact and get all pissed off, all the Air Force chain of command has to do is be like, oh, you guys didn't get that memo? We sent it. At which point they're...
So this is where they said they're not looking to ask for permission. They'll ask forgiveness. You heard of that before?
Basically going to be forced to just drop the issue because none of them are going to want to take responsibility for not passing along the memo that never actually got sent. So that's it. This mission gets approved. Operation Bolo is going to happen. So they hurry up. They get all the jamming pods off of F-105s. They mount them on the F-4s. And while that's going on, they schedule it with the entire U.S. military, all four branches, that nobody is to have planes in the air on January 2nd, 1967, except for the NSA, of course. Somebody forgot to tell them. So January 2nd rolls around. The Silver Dawn spy planes are already in the air. The F-4s are on the airstrip with the jamming pods mounted and they're ready to go. And it's fucking cloudy and overcast out, which is not good for this entire mission. But also, fuck it. There's nothing they can do. They have to run this mission right now. They shut down the skies over all of Southeast Asia to get this shit done. It has to happen right now or it's never gonna happen. But I mean, hey, it should all work out. I mean, even inside of the Art of War, Sun Tzu once said, and I quote,
dude, you can plan a pretty picnic,
but you can't predict the weather. Wait a minute. How did the lyrics to Miss Jackson get inside of my I guess I was on Andre 3000. I apologize. A trillion times. Anyways, point stands. The mission goes. So the F-4s get put up in the air, and there's seven F-4s. Each flight is four F-4s for a total of 28, and they are all named after cars. Flight 1 is named Olds, being led by Robin Olds. Flight 2 is Ford, led by Chappie. And Flight 3 is Rambler, being led by Captain John Stone. And everything they do follows exactly what the F-105s would normally do. They're taking the same route.
I'm in total learning mode right now, guys.
Using the same radio frequencies. They're even using bomber call signs in case somehow their radio transmissions get intercepted, and they're emitting the same jamming frequencies as well using those pods. So sure enough, the MiGs show up, and wouldn't you know it, the first guy to see one is none other than Robin Olds. He immediately splits his flight into two groups of two, and Olds and his wingman take off after this MiG. Olds fires two radar-guided missiles, and they both end up losing their lock, and he misses entirely. He then closes the distance more so he can fire a heat-seeking missile, and it's a dud. And then...
The whole idea of like dogfights is already like crazy to me just to think about them in the air. You have all this like maneuvering and stuff like that. But now with the speeds and firepower that they're talking about here, it just like blows my mind that it can like, I don't know. It's hard for me to like digest that can even like happen. Like it's crazy.
And the MiG that he's chasing goes into the clouds and he loses them entirely. And as soon as he loses sight of that MiG, another MiG is screaming past him, going the opposite direction, so close that Olds can't just make a normal turn. Without batting an eye, Olds immediately hits a vector roll, which is a technique right out of the World War II dogfighting handbook. It's a
I can't handle the, like, that kind of movement.
And you do a backflip.
I don't know how those pilots handle
behind your enemy.
And that kind of movement and those speeds.
Upside down, pulling G's, he gets a radio transmission from Captain John of Rambler Group saying, hey, I just got into the battlefield. Where are you? I heard that you're engaging an enemy. Olds finishes the vector roll, gets behind this MiG, radios back to Stone, finds your own, and then fires a missile and blows up the first.
Oh my God.
At this point, the rest of the
MiG is like a freaking video game to these guys. Find your own. Oh my gosh.
The Americans have tricked them and they are now basically locked inside of the Thunderdome and they're going to have to fight their way out to have any chance at all. And the entire thing devolves into one enormous dogfight. And remember, the other four flights aren't there yet. They're lagging behind a couple of minutes. So we still just have the original three flights of Olds, Ford, and Rambler for a total of 12 F4s going toe to toe with an unknown number of MiGs, potentially as many as 16. Now, cutting over to Ford flight, Chappie has a MiG on his tail and he has no idea because his radio is malfunctioning. And he can't hear his wingman telling him, hey, you have an enemy on your tail. So his wingman does the only thing he can think of. He handles it by himself. Bear in mind, it is Chappie, the MiG, and then his teammate. So his teammate can't fire any missiles because he can't risk that missile accidentally locking onto Chappie. Right. So he has to perform another vector.
That stuff too. I'd be so, it's like so afraid of friendly fire and stuff. And those are things you can't get wrong. In like a dogfight, you can't get that wrong. Crazy how skilled and coordinated and stuff these guys have to be, all while doing this at mock speeds.
This is up, does a corkscrew, backflips, and that puts him 90 degrees from where he was previously. So now he's coming this way towards the enemy, and he fires heat-seeking missiles and blows up the MiG-21 behind Chappie without Chappie even knowing that it happened. Wow. Chappie then immediately engages two MiGs that are directly in front of him, and while that's going on, cutting back over to Olds, his wing. Man informs him that, hey, his secondary fuel tank isn't feeding fuel for some reason, so he's already low on fuel. They are 5 minutes into this dogfight, and Robin Olds makes the call that he is going to escort his wingman out of the target area and back to the airfield, which is yet again another phenomenal display of leadership. He could have ordered somebody else to do it so he could have stayed in the fight and soaked up more kills and padded his stats, but no, he did it himself. For the next 8 minutes, the remaining 10 F4s engage every MiG-21 they can find until they have either been blown up or have disappeared and are hiding in the clouds. So at this point, the F4s call it a day. They head back to base. The other four flights of F4s didn't even make it to the target zone in time, so only 12 of the 28 F4s in the air actually engage the enemy. As the F4s start showing up and they start landing, the ground crews are there waiting with anticipation to find out how it went. I mean, this is one of the coolest missions ever done, probably the coolest thing a lot of these guys are ever going to be involved with, so they're super pumped to hear how it went. As the F4 canopies open up, the pilots start holding up fingers of ones and twos, telling everybody how many MiGs they shot down, and the entire place turns into an enormous party. They're celebrating. All these guys are just absolutely pumped that they shot down a bunch of MiG-21s. So they debrief, trying to figure out everything that happened in this 13 minutes of absolute chaos. And first and foremost, the best news, not a single American pilot got shot down. Then they figure out that they for sure shot down 7 MiG-21s with an additional 2 probable for a total of as many as 9. And bear in mind that the North Vietnamese only had somewhere between 12 and 16 to begin with. So,
you know, the interesting thing is how little effect this is going to have, though, on the like the war itself, right? Like, there's so much bigger things at play here that even with these, like, you know, from a military perspective, such incredible successes, how it still will not get the U.S. any closer to some whatever victory is supposed to look like.
So at worst, Operation Bolo has effectively destroyed at least half of North Vietnam's MiG-21 fleet. Okay, and there's always going to be that one guy in the comments section like, buh, I can't believe you made an entire video about them only shooting down 7 aircrafts, buh. Okay, first of all, this isn't a video game.
And that's, by the way, that's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying it's, like, the mission, it was incredible, like, from that perspective. But the impact it actually made on the overall outcome of the war, negligible that way.
Life and going 7-0 against peer aircrafts is absolutely incredible. Secondly, yeah. In a way, Operation Bolo destroy half of the enemy MiG-21 fleet. It also destroyed their entire fleet's operational capability, and that is because now they can't make a mistake like that again because they've lost half of their fucking planes. If they do that, they won't have any. In addition to that, now they have no way of knowing if it's actually a bunch of F-105s are getting sent up to fight or if it's another trap. So now the remaining MiG-21s are going to be infinitely more cautious and more sparingly used, which is going to save countless F-105s in the long run. So in conclusion, Operation Bolo has gone down in history as one of the most successful ruses of all time, and it serves as a shining example of why you should never underestimate a couple of old men in a young man's game. In addition to that, it also proved something that I previously thought to be impossible, that you can in fact overcome the stupidity of politicians. The bad news is that you have to be a superhero level badass like Robin Olds or Daniel Chappie James Jr. Thank you for watching. Best way to support the channel is go buy some merch over thefatelectrician.com. Quack bang out.
Final thoughts. All right, so obviously incredible operational success here from this, especially given the scenario that the military was put in as far as what you can and can't do in this conflict. Hopefully you saw, you know, how you saw that, or saw this as evidence of how complicated this war was to engage in and how there were so many things at play at the same time that was influencing how the war was being conducted, which of course, again, brings in a whole bunch of different questions that I posed to you during the war about this war and just in general and its success versus, risk reward, I guess is better, a better way to put it here, but show the complication of it and hopefully you're able to see the bigger picture of what was, what was at play here and giving that historical context that is so important to understand during conflicts, because there's so many things again at play. So, all right. With that, again, incredible story there. Thank you, Fat Electrician, keeps putting out this content, and you guys keep wanting more and more of it. I really appreciate all the suggestions I get. I definitely, as soon as he puts out a video, see in my suggestions channel over on Discord, you guys put it in there, and appreciate that. So as long as you want to keep seeing me cover it, I'm going to keep doing it. So with that, we'll see y'all next time. Bye.